So the previous speakers have talked about the nuts and bolts of the program, and I wanted to take this in a little bit different direction. So I call my presentation A Journey Through Time, and I want to talk about the evolution of bloodless medicine and surgery programs in this country. So we're going to open up our time capsule here, and we're going to look at what's the past been, what's happening now, and what's in the future for bloodless medicine and surgery programs. Okay, so I'm going to first start off with the HLC came in and gave a presentation to the anesthesia department. And Mike Randolph got up and sat in front of him and started off, and he started from the Bible and started talking about who was the first anesthesiologist. And I'm like, I have no idea. And he said, God. And I thought, oh, yeah. You know, and so that got me to thinking when I was putting this program together, who was the first bloodless medicine and surgery physician? Can anybody guess? Any guesses? This is not in your handoff. I left this out. So I got to thinking, who is that? And I went through the literature. I went on the library, and I said, I need to find out who this was. And I found out who it was. And this is who it is. Now, think about this now. Think about this. Have you ever seen Dr. McCoy Bones give blood in a Star Trek episode? No. Everything was bloodless. So we give him the credit of being the first physician, the first bloodless medicine and surgery physician. Okay, we're going to talk about the evolution of the first bloodless program. When was the first bloodless medicine and surgery program in this country started? Any guess? What year? Who said 1987? Somebody said it. You get the prize. You get free surgery. By Dr. Evans. He'll give you your certificate right afterwards. Yes, the first bloodless medicine program was established in 1987 at Our Lady of Resurrection Medical Center in Chicago. By the end of the 1990s, there were 552 programs. Can anybody guess how many programs there are now? God, you guys know all the answers. Correct. There are nearly 200 official programs throughout the country. What a tremendous impact. I mean, this is a lot of programs going on. And this now, this is the last big metropolitan area to have a program. And we are so excited about it being here at Georgetown University Hospital. Now, the picture I'm going to show, and I will bring that up, this is my cat Cheerios. When he heard I got the job here as a nursing coordinator, he said, give me a high five. And I said, absolutely. Absolutely. So I am very excited to be the nursing coordinator of this program. I have a passion for blood conservation, which goes back to my time when I was at the hospital center and caring for a patient who was a Jehovah's Witness who just had coronary artery bypass graft. And I said, I didn't know anything about how to take care of this patient. I said, what do I do? Don't give any blood. Okay, what else do I do? And there was no program in place. So I developed a program. Interestingly enough, I was working the night shift. The next morning, and this is how great God works, the next morning, I'm ready to go to bed, and some witnesses come to my door. They knock on my door, and I go, can I help you? And they said, we are with the Jehovah's Witness. Come on in. I never saw bigger smiles on their faces. So that got me involved with the witness community, and I said, I want to know about your religion, and why don't you accept blood and everything? And they talked to me and they said, we're going to put you in touch with Ken Pinckney. And I've known Ken now for about 6 years, and he has been a resource to me But I developed a program, and I said to the physicians, the cardiac physicians at the hospital center, they have done a lot of witnesses over there. They have a great program for the witness community. And I said to them, I said, why don't we do a blood conservation program? So I got up in front of all of them, and this is the first time a nurse got up in front of their committee and presented and said, we need to have a blood conservation program. And so I developed that with the chief of perfusion and my medical director, Dr. Lewis, and we developed that program over there. And we changed our practice based upon the way we took care of the witnesses that came in. We changed our practice for everybody. So I was very excited, and I'm very excited to be here. Okay. There are three main important events that I've taken from history and said, how did these events impact the development of bloodless medicine and surgery programs? The first one was obviously the formation of the hospital information services for the Jehovah's Witness. Unbelievable. It was not until they really came along that they went out to the medical community and says, we're going to find doctors who are going to work with us, okay, who are going to abide by our religious beliefs, and they're going to say, I want to take care of you. It's tremendous. The next thing was Dr. Denton Cooley. I don't know if many of you are familiar, but he was the first one that really developed bloodless cardiac surgery. Amazing. Now, he was in Texas, and he was really at the forefront of developing bloodless medicine, bloodless surgeries. And, of course, the AIDS epidemic. So I'm going to talk about all three of these in a little bit here. And we're going to look at some of these historical events and how they shaped the formation of bloodless medicine and surgery programs. Obviously, the hospital information services, it's the first time there was a concentrated effort to educate the medical community about alternatives to blood transfusion. You know, physicians didn't think that way. And then the development of research-based clinical strategies to care for the Jehovah's Witness. These are amazing little booklets. They really are. And they have helped me, and they have helped our department. So they are just fantastic. And they're very well research-based. And they have really changed the way we practice. And now bloodless medicine is becoming the standard of care in hospitals across the country. I'm going to talk a little bit about Dr. Cooley's study and what he did in 19. He published his results in 1967. Unheard of. Unheard of is doing cardiac surgery, which is the number one surgery that causes the greatest loss of blood. And later in 1977, he published a more extensive paper where he looked at over 500 patients that he did, witness patients. And he found no difference. They didn't die more. He was just more meticulous in the way he took care of them. Until this time, if you had gone in for surgery, cardiac surgery, most surgeons across this country said, I'm not going to do you unless you accept blood. But he did, and he was really at the forefront of changing the ideas of surgeons, said, you know what, we can do this. We can do this for all types of surgery. And, of course, the last thing is the AIDS epidemic. Prior to the AIDS epidemic, blood was thought as, this was our psyche in this country and all across the world, that blood saved lives. And it was not until the AIDS epidemic that the community as a whole learned, you know, maybe that's not true all the time. Okay? And so it really changed our thinking, and people became afraid. At this time this was going on, I worked at a hospital in Texas. And they had found out that one of their anesthesiologists died of AIDS. He had taken part in 5,000 surgeries. They contacted all 5,000 people and said, come on in, we're going to test you for AIDS. We had lineups, and I was helping to draw blood on these individuals. And you could see people were afraid. People were saying, am I going to die? they asked me this. I said, I don't know. You know, I don't know. We were so afraid because of the AIDS epidemic. And guess what happened? Blood donations declined. People said, you know what? I don't want to get in and get stuck by a needle. I might get AIDS just giving blood. And now what we see is that decline has continued, but the use of blood has gone up. The supply has gone down, the demand has gone up. That doesn't work. You know how that works with oil, right? So, all right, so Dr. Cooley took up the challenge of providing successful high-risk cardiac surgery for the witness community. Slowly, as blood management therapies developed, more and more surgical options became available to the witness community by the 1980s. But there were still no formal programs in existence in the country. Bloodless programs have transformed the medical practice, okay? Now, most major surgical procedures can be done transfusion-free. Cardiac, orthopedic, gynecological, hepatic, and even transplants. Okay. There are still challenging areas, and those are hematology, oncology. But there's more and more research being produced that even some aspects of these areas of medicine are being done transfusion-free. The benefits. I really want to talk about how the witness community has really helped our understanding and really has made a tremendous impact on medical literature. Okay? Some of the benefits that you as a witness community have given to us, the medical community, has been the development of blood management therapies. Blood management is becoming an integral part of everyday surgical practice. There is a greater awareness in the medical community of blood management strategies, and hospitals with comprehensive patient blood management programs have a significant reduction in costs associated with transfusion. It's estimated that for each transfusion, it costs the hospital overall close to $1,000. Now, if you transfuse 1,000, if you give 1,000 transfusion every month, that's a lot of money. It's a lot of money a hospital is spending. So this contribution that the Jehovah's Witnesses have made to the medical literature include development of bloodless surgical techniques. We have a better understanding of now how the human body tolerates profound anemia. It's really interesting. And I'm very much into this in looking at the idea of a very low hemoglobin and how the body reacts to that. And because of the witness community, the medical community has developed a unique care model that is gradually being adapted as the best practice. And we now know that patient rights matter. So I'd like to give everybody a hand in the witness community. I'd like to thank you. As part of the medical profession, I would like to thank you for your contribution to us. The future. What's the future hold for us? Well, transfusion-free medicine is quickly becoming best practice across the world. Patient blood management will become the standard of care in medicine. Bloodless medicine and church surgery programs will continue to see growth. And Georgetown University Hospital Blood Management Surgery Program is here to serve you. And today we begin our journey. I hope you will join us. And can I get another high five?
Welcome. I'm Mark Zawadzki, and he had the little introduction there. And I just wanted to give a little bit of an overview of how we put it together, the actual program, how we anticipate, the flow through in terms of getting involved into Georgetown for patients and the resources that we're putting together for physicians. You know, part of what we talked about is, you know, we're trying to limit the need for transfusion, if not avoid it completely, just across the board, because there are many studies that I'll talk about in a moment that looks at the benefits of reducing the amount of blood transfusions in general. And it's a major undertaking in the United States and very expensive and very big part of the healthcare dollar. You know, that we look at over $5 billion annually related specifically to blood transfusions in the United States. And a lot of it really comes in surgical procedures. It's the blood supply in general has become safer over the years, but it still carries significant risks, both from the blood itself, from the impact of what's going on when we do transfusions. And you see some of the rates of complications are pretty high and somewhat significant. There's a process called immunomodulation that we think relates is part of the reason why there's a higher infection rate when we have transfusion. So we try to lower the, I think there's a general benefit from that. And being a joint replacement surgeon, infections is something that we really, is a major concern for us. Part of the historical process of what we base transfusions on, a lot of residency programs, and we've kind of grown up over time using benchmarks of a hemoglobin level of 10 or a hematocrit of 30. It's really just been something that's been out there that we've used, and not really with a lot of scientific medical fact behind it. And more recently, there have been a lot of studies that have looked at what lower transfusion guidelines would do, and we found in general that it's really been beneficial. These are some of the trials that have been out there, some back to 1995, where the 30 what's a measurement of patient follow-up, a 30-day mortality rate, shows that heart attacks, pulmonary problems, a lot of the things that we worry about post-surgery for sick medical patients is reduced in sick patients. And this was a study that was done in ICU patients. So we saw some benefit there. This was a review of a lot of different studies that they looked at, and when you use a higher rate for transfusions, the complication rates are higher. So there's a lot of data that's being gathered, even and again in sick patients and people undergoing cardiac procedures, cardiac surgery. They looked across the country at the rates of transfusion, and just simply by the region that you lived in, you saw tremendous variations without any worse or better outcomes. For instance, they just looked at New England region showed a 4% rate of transfusions, and the Southeast United States was a 23%. And again, this was all kind of corrected, so you're kind of comparing the same type of patient, and so it shows a lot of what we do is really just based on habit in some ways. And there's some good evidence that trying to minimize and lower the rates of transfusion across the board, it helps medically. And this was, so that kind of led to some of the, our look to start looking at our transfusion processes and trying to, see what we could do in terms of a bloodless program. And then we talked about that, that there really isn't any major program here in D.C. It's a large patient population, and we're trying to, match it to our mission, within Georgetown that I think the video, really pointed out well. And it's good for all patients. And so part of the structure of what we were, we're trying to put together, we'll have a website on our general hospital webpage that will have information specific to the bloodless surgery program. It's both designed for patients looking to get information as well as the providers in the hospital. So we'll have an educational material there, and we're looking to develop training modules and different things like that to kind of promote the transfer of knowledge throughout the staff. In terms of patient access to the program, you'll meet the other members of the team. We'll have a central contact point both through the website as well as with the phone, and we have pager. We're kind of on call so that we're available. And the idea is that we'll coordinate the overall care. So when you contact Georgetown or you're identified as being part of this program, then we could help you find the proper providers and also help match up match you up across the board, you know, with the appropriate people you're talking to. We'll also have educational materials, and one of the things that I found, I do total joints, I do hip and knee replacements, and there was nothing worse than, you know, I'm sure Steve feels the same way, that, you know, we kind of meet, we've scheduled our surgery, we're down in the holding area, and then there's an, oh, by the way, you know, I don't accept blood transfusions. And that's really the absolute wrong time to start having that conversation. And believe me, that it's bad enough for us. We've already, you know, we've scheduled the surgery. It's the anesthesia team that kind of really, you know, that doesn't like that. So that's a big, you know, that, in my opinion, is really one of the most important things that we can do, is just educate the staff, educate patients all, and have the conversations beforehand, not as we're considering surgery. And I think that's really what the goal of having an organized program is all about. I'm just have to back my way through here. This is sort of, in terms of what we actually do, like what is a bloodless surgery program, there's really three parts of it. And, you know, we try to the pre-surgical or pre-medical aspect, where we try to optimize, meaning we try to get everybody as healthy as you can be and try to minimize anemia beforehand. And then we try to prevent the loss of blood. That's probably the best way to avoid, you know, any problems and needs for transfusion. And then post-surgery, post-treatment, you know, there's different things we could do in terms of the recovery process. You know, pre-surgery, you look at what the procedures are, what we expect, and then depending if it's a low-risk procedure, there's not that much you need to do. If it's something, a procedure where a revision hip replacement, we know there can be a fair amount of blood loss. We'll try to see whether we could get an iron supplementation, we could do some medications like the Procrit or EPO-protein, if that's appropriate, that can help. You can turn on your blood-producing cells themselves, and you try to get your level up so that if you lose some blood, you're still in a safe zone. And so that's all that we can do, you know, in advance. And then during surgery or, you know, during procedures, we try to minimize blood loss. It's relatively simple. There are just the surgical techniques. Keeping patients warm during the surgery can make a big difference in terms of the amount of blood loss that you see. There's different agents that we could put on that help during surgery to prevent blood loss as well. There's different devices we can use, and some of this is acceptable from a witness, you know, from a religious standpoint. Some, you know, it varies, but again, if we have a program, we could talk about it in advance and, you know, have different resources to really, you know, decide whether or not you might accept that or not. We'll have a sample of what's called a cell saver machine, where we collect the blood during surgery. It's filtered and it's maintained through an IV, so it's somewhat of a closed loop system. There's some anesthetic techniques where hemodilution, and some of this, you know, we can go over. We'll have more information on as time goes by. After surgery, we try to keep fluid levels up so you have good circulatory stability after surgery. There's a thing called a reinfusion drain that's after knee replacements, for instance, there's a lot of little exposed bone, and you get a little oozing of blood afterwards, and we leave drains in place. And the drain can go through a filtered collection device and through an IV that then goes, remains connected to your circulatory system and gets reinfused, so for the first few hours after surgery. So again, these are not for everyone, but it's a type of thing that we can talk about, some of the techniques, and then we can get you on, you know, iron supplementation, the stimulate blood cell medications, and the other simple thing is limiting the amount of blood tests that we do. There's a habit that we fall into where we're checking blood levels of different things all along, and we really can cut that back, and that helps as well. Again, it's sort of the idea that the best way to have bloodless medicine is to avoid losing it. And, you know, we're just looking for a program where we could provide resources for patients, for the physicians providing care, and try to, you know, practice medicine at the highest level of care that we can. And that's it.